Justice Reardon for Appellant Harkonen, and I too will attempt to watch the clock and preserve a few minutes for rebuttal. The key event in this case occurred 15 years ago. The court heard a direct appeal in 2013, but I submit that the importance of the case and the importance of the correct resolution of the case is as important today, and no less important today than it has been at any time in those 15 years. And the reason is that the Harkonen conviction remains within the scientific community a subject of much discussion about the issue of whether it imposes a real limit on scientific speech. Just as in any drug trial, the most important variable is mortality, as one of the elements in this discussion, I would submit that in any criminal case, this court is going to be very interested in the question of whether the defendant, in fact, committed a crime. And I'm going to begin there, because I submit that in the wake of the Matrix case, in the wake of the 2012 passage by Congress of the Food and Drug Administration Safety Improvement Act of 2012, in the wake of the consensus statement of the American Statistical Society in 2016, Dr. Harkonen could not be charged today, much less convicted. He could not be charged today because the theory on which the biostatistical theory on which he was convicted has been completely refuted by the Supreme Court, by Congress itself, and by the relevant scientific community, that is, statisticians and biostatisticians. There's no question here that the raw data of this test trial showed that 40% of the subjects who took this drug survived, 40% greater rate of survival among all the participants, and 70% greater rate of survival among the mild to moderate group, who are 77% of the total in the test. The New England Journal of Medicine, when it analyzed this in 2004, said there's only one false statement that can be made about these test results, and that false statement would be that it did not demonstrate a survival benefit. I mean, given that relevant scientific community, the opinions stated in this press release were reasonable. They were scientifically reasonable. And because that's true, under the McNulty rule, they could not be found false or fraudulent, a reasonable expression of scientific opinion. In 2009, the government gained a conviction by stating to the jury that if you don't have a statistically significant result of 0.05 or lower on the primary endpoint of a test, you may not draw any conclusion, no conclusion. Any conclusion that you draw is false and misleading. That is the argument upon which they want a conviction.
Let me ask you something about that. That struck me as critical. And usually, when you look for a correlation between two variables, it means nothing without statistical significance. However, sometimes it does. Now, you said you got your case basically out of the government's expert, and that often happens. What did the government expert do to explain what statistical significance means to the jury? How did he explain it?
Well, the government's principal witness, Thomas Fleming, said just that. If you don't get a statistically significant result of 0.05 or less on your primary endpoint, everything else that you say, any conclusion about ethical...
No, that's not what I'm asking. Most jurors don't know what it means. Anybody who's studied any statistics at all does it. One way to explain it is by the comparison to the null hypothesis, right? Complicated. Another way is coin flip. Flip a coin, it comes up heads. Doesn't mean it's a dirty coin. Flip it twice, hits both times. Well, there's one chance in four that it would. That's not significant. Third time, one chance in eight would come up heads. All three times, still not significant. Fourth flip, one chance in 16, still doesn't suggest anything funny about the coin. One chance in 32, the fifth flip or fourth flip, I can't remember anymore, that's less than, there's less than one chance in 20 of that happening by chance. So it gets a p-value better than 0.05, lower than 0.05. That's statistically significant. That's how the professor explained it to me. Did the expert explain to the jury what he meant by not statistically significant or statistically significant?
He explained what, and because it wasn't contradicted by any defense expert, what he said is that, as Judge Patel discussed his testimony, 0.05 is a magic value.
0.05, what though? Did he say what it meant? Did he talk about coin flips or anything else?
Well, the
did he explain to the jury it means less than one chance in 20 of it happening just by random events?
Well, but the thrust of the testimony is that anything that doesn't have a 0.05 value, and in this case it was on lung capacity, means that anything else that you say about trial results is unreliable. So in this case you have indisputably.
I'm curious, did you put your fellow Ganesh Raghu, MD, on the stand?
No, he was a government witness. And he was a government witness. And, Your Honor, when the FDA or the government comes after people, it tends to have an effect. Dr. Raghu was a author of the 2004 New England Journal of Medicine analysis, which said that the only false statement that you could make about this test was that it did not have a mortality benefit.
So what did he say on the stand about?
Well, and let me also add, he, in the press release, said that these results were compelling.
That's why I asked you.
Right. On the stand, he said, gee whiz, I guess I really didn't have a full sense of what was going on in the case. And what we've demonstrated in our reply brief is that Dr. Raghu made affirmative statements, not only in the press release, but for years later. It was only when the government chose to indict people in this case that he gladly became a prosecution witness. But I submit this, Your Honor. If you turn to the government in this case and say you got a conviction by saying that if the primary primary endpoint doesn't produce a value of 0.05 or later, no conclusions are permissible. Are you willing to?
You know, it sounds to me like you're just repeating that phrase, but you have not given me what any witness explained to the jury about what 0.05 means.
But the point that
less than half of 1% or 5/100ths of 1% of what?
Well, the point also is that, in fact, if you looked at mortality benefit as opposed to the lung capacity, among the mild to moderate group, the p-value was 0.004. It was amazingly compelling. But the government's position is, no, you can't look at mortality because it's not the primary endpoint. So, and their position was that any conclusion such as the 0.004 determination of mortality benefit among this group was necessarily false and misleading. But they can't maintain that today because the United States Supreme Court in Matrix said that is nonsense. Medical regulators and professionals make judgments about causations based on factors other than p-values and statistical analysis, and it is simply untrue that statistical analysis is be-all and end-all of inference about causation.
But it has nothing to do with causation.
Matrix says that, but in fact, Dr. Harkonen only presented statistical evidence in the press release.
Well, that's not, well, Your Honor, specifically, one of the things that Matrix says is that a factor other than simple p-values are consistency among studies. And this is the press release specifically says that one of the reasons to be optimistic, and notice, Dr. Harkin in the press release said it may demonstrate indicates that it may extend the life of patients, and specifically they relied on the Zelta, the prior study done in Switzerland. That this was the second study, and the release says this, that showed a positive mortality benefit among IPF patients. So it is not true that he relied only on this. And, Your Honor, I would submit if this press release said, our study demonstrates that 40% more of people who take our medicine survive than the entire population. Our study demonstrates that 70% more in this group survive, then that's just the raw data. You don't need p-values to make the statement. When you're dealing with a fatal disease, as the statement, the press release says, there is an ethical obligation to bring to the public that a great deal more people survived who took this drug than did not. So, Your Honor, I would submit that it isn't simply a reliance on p-values and biased statistics. It's a reliance on the raw data of survivals in this case.
But before you end your time, I just want to save some time for rebuttal. Why did Harkonen wait 5 months to file the writ of coram nobis?
As Judge Seaborg said, and that's page ER 11, he accepted the reasons why it took 5 months, which were, and quite frankly, not only was this an enormous record, but you're talking about a decision, admittedly, to challenge the decisions of someone, you know, as Judge Seaborg said, who has been in this community and has a reputation in this community, and it required not only an examination of all of the defense trial team's files, but it required a face-to-face interview with the team to get their statements about what happened. So Judge Seaborg did not find any failing in the 5 months that it took to file the writ. He found a failing in the failure to raise a IAC claim prior to sentencing.
I wondered about that, too. Why, once you're at sentencing, you had new lawyers, and once your fellow was sentenced, he had some limitations on his liberty. Why couldn't he file a habeas at that point to say, my verdict was tainted by ineffective assistance, and therefore, I should have my freedom?
I can answer that question because I dealt with this in another case. The rules of this court say that once a judgment is submitted, you are barred from raising a 2255 until such time as the direct appeal has been exhausted. So he was legally barred from raising it before that.
Why couldn't he raise on direct appeal an ineffective assistance challenge, ineffective assistance counsel claim?
For two reasons, Your Honor. One, under the law of this court, IAC claims are strongly, strongly discouraged on direct appeal. But furthermore, you cannot, on direct appeal, make reference to any information that was not placed before the jury. And as this court said in 2013...
Oh, before the district court, you mean?
That was not... Before the jury in this case is what we're talking about, the evidence.
Oh, no, before the district court. Well, certainly on direct appeal, raise things that were before the district court, and the ineffective assistance might have been raised as early as the sentencing phase.
But Your Honor,
motion for new trial phase.
Well, a new trial motion was brought by the trial attorney. So once they did that, it was over in terms of the ability to raise another new trial motion. You only get one shot at that. And they couldn't raise it because they were the trial attorneys. But, Your Honor, I will point out to you that this court on direct appeal said the most convincing evidence in support of Dr. Harkonnen's claim was not presented to the jury, and therefore we will not consider it, which is why we are here on a collateral attack, because the court said it wasn't before the trial jury.
I had a lot of trouble with your ineffective assistance claim, not on the prejudice issue, I didn't get to that, but on the question of whether they competently represented the defendant when they didn't put on an expert. And the problem I had is, when they talked to their experts the night before they were going to put them on, their witnesses went south on them.
Your Honor, on what basis could you say that? Because if you look at the declarations of Dr. Seaborg, Dr. Mayer, and Ron Winchell, they directly contradict that is what occurred. And so how can you accept...
Tell me where to look at it. I've obviously missed something here. tell me where to look.
Well, what happens?
The excerpts are really big. Give me a reference so I can look it up.
I will provide you with the specific ER references when I get up, sit down and get up again. But the point is simply this, Your Honor, that everything said about that interview with Dr. Mayer was by Mr. Topel and his lawyers was contradicted by Dr. Mayer's description of what went on in this. At a minimum, if the court the court below or this court were to rely on the declarations of the trial team, who obviously have an axe to grind in this, it had to do so only after hearing the disputed testimony of the witnesses who took that issue. And so the court below refused to hold an evidentiary hearing, even though these declarations are in extreme tension with one another. We submit that at a minimum, if the court were to go off and say, I have a problem with your IAC, given what the defense lawyers had to say, it would require a remand where that those declarations are contested by the declarations that were put in evidence contradicting.
I just want to read them.
Yeah.
Everybody's had the experience if they try cases of just before they put their witness on, the witness goes south on them, so you tell the witness you won't be needing them after all. And that's basically what the government says happens.
I'll sit down, Your Honor. What happened in this case was, and I believe this, Attorney Topel said, we've got the case win. We're not going to put on experts. I believe that. That's very consistent with Mark Topel. However, when they lost the case, he came before the court and said, you have to acquit because they didn't have any expert testimony. They didn't put any in. So, therefore, they lose because there was no expert testimony out of it. Judge Patel said, don't be silly. I let all of that expert testimony in. So the contemporary record.
Well, a lawyer has a perfect right to be inconsistent in the arguments he makes on different occasions, unless there's a judicial estoppel involved, which there isn't here. I don't understand why that matters.
Well, it matters for this reason. You stand up in court and tell Judge Patel, I'm going to call this witness tomorrow. After you fail to call him, you write a motion that says, A, they didn't have any expert testimony, which was nonsense, and B, here's all of the kind of expert testimony citing articles that we could have and should have presented. And she said, I'm not paying any attention to that. You didn't put it before the jury. It's only years later, when the decision is challenged on a 2255, that we get the explanation that, oh, no, our witness went south, which is directly contradicted by the testimony of Dr. Mayer. One final point on this, and this makes a big difference. In most cases, as a trial lawyer, as you know, Judge Kleinfeld, you're deciding, if I put this witness on, maybe they'll go south and I'll weaken my case. But under the law of McNulty, the very admission of Dr. Mayer's testimony as a prestigious biostatistician means that it didn't have to beat the other side. Once it was in, Judge Patel or this court on appeal would have had to grant an acquittal because under the McNulty rule, his testimony about the efficacy and statements you can make about a drug trial was reasonable.
I'm trying to remember, was he the guy who was going to say, I wouldn't prescribe it because it kills too many people? There was some doctor who said that, and I can't remember for sure.
Well, Your Honor, the other witness they didn't call at trial, Dr. Zebrack of the Harvard Medical School, was going to testify, I knew about the results of this. I continued to prescribe ActiMmune, and it continued to help my patients. They didn't put him on either. And the notion that he couldn't be called, and I'm getting into the weeds perhaps, because he could be rebutted by a study taken 5 years later, is nonsense because Judge Patel said no study 5 years later is relevant to the truth or falsity or good faith of the statements that were made in 2002. I realize I've overextended my time.
Yes, thank you
very much.
Counsel.
Good afternoon, Your Honors. My name is Mary Jean Chan, and I represent the United States in this appeal. The district court correctly concluded that the defendant was not eligible and did not qualify for the extraordinary remedy of coram nobis for two reasons. First, as this court panel alluded to, he didn't meet the second of the four prongs or criteria factors under Hirabayashi. He could have filed but failed to earlier file the claims that he raises in his petition. And secondly, because he doesn't meet the fourth factor, which is that he doesn't raise an error, or there's no error of a fundamental nature that taints his conviction. Starting with just the timeliness, what I'll call the timeliness factor, this court's decision in Riedel, which was cited extensively by Judge Seaborg in his order denying the petition for coram nobis, very, I think, explicitly governs this case. The defendant was somebody who was very well-resourced. Not only is he educated, but he's well-resourced. At trial, he had not only Sidley Austin attorneys working for him, but also an entire team of attorneys, at least five from the Kasowitz firm. And then he had somebody to kind of overlook and give him second opinion on all of that, and that was Ronald Winchell. He had all these people, and then after his conviction, he fired the Kasowitz team, and then he had Mark Haddad and the Sidley Austin team helping him. And then after that, he hired Alan Levin to sue Marcus Tappell in state court for professional negligence. This is somebody who is very well resourced. And he failed at any of these times, the multiple decision points or times when he could have to file.
When did he sue Tappell for negligence?
Let me find that very quickly, Your Honor. He sued Mr. Tappell on August 3rd, 2011. So he had been sentenced in April of 2011. And prior to that, on August 26th, 2010, he had terminated Tappell. And this was, just to give you context, too, the direct appeal in this case was resolved in May 2013, 2 years later from the time when he sued Tappell in civil court.
So was he foreclosed from bringing his habeas until May 2013?
I don't believe that he is. I'm not familiar with what Mr. Reardon was saying about the case law that forecloses him. I think that he could have brought it at any time, and I think this court is familiar too that many times ineffective assistance of claims, counsel claims, are brought before direct appeal and are actually adjudicated on direct appeal. The record, as the district court noted,
rarely adjudicate them on direct appeal.
Rarely, if the
problem with taking on direct appeal is you want to hear what the lawyer has to say, but he can't say it because of his duty to his client, assuring the direct appeal.
Right, but Tappell, in this case, it was an unusual situation because he was actually terminated years before the sentencing. Not years, maybe a year before the sentencing.
I guess another reason why we don't entertain him usually on direct appeal is maybe the guy went on appeal and will never have to entertain him.
Certainly, Your Honor, but again, the certiorari petition was denied in December. And he didn't finish his probation sentence until 4 months after that. And by the way, the reason it terminated only 4 months after that was because he specifically made the strategic call not to stay his sentence. At the time of sentencing, Judge Patel said, well, shall we just stay your sentence? I'm giving you 3 years probation as opposed to the 10 years requested by the government of custodial time. Would you like that stayed? He said, no, I got probation. I want it to run. So by the time that we're talking about April, that's why it ran. But still, he had 4 months between the time of the certiorari denial and the time of the end of his custodial sentence. He could have raised that. We would expect that of prisoners who are actually in custody, who are not well-resourced, who are not well-educated. We expect them to file their 2255 motions in a timely manner. So there's really no excuse for the defendant in this case not doing so and then saying, well, now I need to have this extraordinary remedy of coram nobis, which has only been really used in a handful of times, I think, in this court, because it's such a great, grave injustice. I think that simply isn't right, and that is why the district court was correct in saying that based upon simply factor two, he doesn't meet the requirements for coram nobis. But not.
Let me ask you now about the attorney negligence claim, the attorney malpractice claim.
Yes.
I just can't imagine a jury who would understand what anyone was talking about with 0.05p less than 0.05 if they didn't have somebody explain to them what that
So just to begin with, Mr. Topel in his closing argument said, I said I was going to present some experts. Actually, I got my expert testimony through the government's experts.
Okay, what did the government's experts say it meant?
The experts said that when you have a p-value of 0.05, that means there's 5% chance that the result that you got that would be as extreme as you got was due to chance as opposed to some sort of causation.
Well, wait a minute. Has nothing to do with causation. It has to do with correlation. If a correlation is striking enough, then you look for causation. But correlations, well, the way the statisticians like to explain it is that wet streets don't cause rain, even though they correlate 100%. The p-value is zero. Any day where you've seen wet streets, there was rain. But it's not the wet streets that cause the rain. Correlation and causation are two different things.
Well, I point you, Your Honor, to the testimony, and I know that this is a huge record that we've given to you to look at and review, but if you look at SER 407 to 53, that's the government's excerpts of records, you'll see Dr. Fleming's testimony. And you can also consult with the section of the excerpts that refer to Dr. Krager's testimony as well. And what Dr. Fleming said was, this is a little bit like a marksman. If you have a Secret Service person and you say, well, let's try to hit the target.
I know, for some reason, it's just kind of a pastime of mine to read medical research just for fun.
Okay.
And I know that, as was claimed in this case, that there is increasing questioning of the requirement of statistical significance in the correlation before you look seriously at the drug. And the reason is that the drug may work very well on some people and not work at all on other people. And if you have a big sample or a very small sample, you may find that you have a correlation that is not statistically significant, because you have to find a subgroup that the drug works to a statistically significant extent on. And that's the reason for the questioning. Did anyone testify about that?
Actually, a number of people testified that exactly what actually Matrix says and what the defendant's experts, Goodman and Rubin, purportedly sort of testified to, which is that it's good science to do post-hoc analysis and to try to find the subgroups and do that afterwards. But in the context of a phase 3 trial, which is what the press release was reporting on, it has a very specific context. InterMune itself specified that the cutoff was P equals 0.05, and that's at Exhibit 281 at page 16. That within that context, when you have the evidence of the defendant going through and meeting, not only it's not only 0.05 or 0.06 or 0.07, it's 0.52. That means it's more likely that this is just random than not. That when you report that and you put out a press release that's aimed at patients and caregivers as well as doctors, and you say that the headline is P equals 0.004. That's not the headline, Your Honor, but that's sort of the first paragraph of the press release. After cutting through the data and finding something that really is not what the study was powered for, it wasn't designed to study this. I mean, just as background, IPF is a disease where from the time
they often discover something that's not what they're looking for, like that stuff for baldness that men use now. They don't give it to women because it causes hirsuteness. It was supposed to be a heart drug. It was just an accident. It turned out to be good for baldness.
And none of the witnesses that the government put on said that it was bad science to say, let's look for something, and, or that we shouldn't continue to go on and look at it. In fact, the FDA eventually approved of the 007 trial, which was sort of devastating because they thought that there was enough of a lead. It was, the correct term would be a trend. There's some data there to suggest that maybe there is a mortality benefit, but it's not to a statistically significant point. And that's really the key thing. All of the witnesses that they wanted to put on will say, and if you look carefully at their declarations, they say that there's some clinical significance, even if there isn't statistical significance. What the press release says is that it is statistically significant. They don't say that the primary endpoint was not met, that the p-value there was 0.52. What they say is the p-value is 0.004. for a point that was not specified in any of the analyses when InterMune was designing the study.
Well, it says that they found a statistically significant benefit in patients with mild to moderate disease, and I thought that turned out to be true. It's just not what they were looking for.
No, Your Honor. So the testimony at trial was that when you talk about statistical significance, that has this very specific meaning. The test, that you can come up with a p-value of something that meets the cutoff, but that doesn't mean it's statistically significant unless it's really sort of powered and directed at what the study is engineered for.
That may be necessary to get the FDA to approve use of the drug on label rather than off label for that particular illness, but it doesn't mean that it's not statistically significant for the particular finding, even though it's not what the study was looking for, and the study had not reached its end point.
That's not what the testimony at trial was, Your Honor. This trial was 21 months. It was not engineered to study for time.
A lot of studies don't meet their end point, either because it's unethical because the drug is killing too many people, or because it's unethical because it's obvious the drug is helping so many people.
The life expectancy for somebody, and this is it, also was 3 to 5 years upon diagnosis of IPF. This study was only 21 months. So the reason mortality was not something that was a primary endpoint or even really one of the top secondary endpoints was because they simply didn't think they'd have enough deaths to really make a statistical significance issue. We had 330 patients in the study as a whole. So 160 of two of them were on Actimmune. Of those who died, we only have the total number of people who died was less than 40. So to try to argue that there was statistical significance from a trial where, and I believe the press release says that this is a large, trial, really misleads the reader as to exactly what the study was, what the point of the study was, and what the statistics means. And that, I think, again, if you go and look at the testimony by Dr. Fleming, Dr. Krager, who are experts, as well as Dr. Walton and some of the other doctors.
How did Dr. Ragu explain away what he's quoted as saying in the press release, the mortality benefit is very compelling and represents a major breakthrough in this difficult disease?
I believe he testified that he was told what the results of the study were by the defendant. So he didn't actually have hands on or eyes on the actual data. And when the defendant said, this is exciting, it's a very positive trial, we've done it, he said, that's great, it's very compelling. And so then it was that quote that they then used in the press release. And he also testified that he hadn't even realized that the quote really was going for or was for the purpose of the press release. And he was surprised when Dr. Fleming
It says here that he was the phase 3 study's lead principal investigator, so presumably he would know the study inside and out. Is that true? Was he the phase 3 study's lead principal investigator?
He was, but there was an issue of unblinding the data, so it was a timing issue. He was not one of the first people who had access to the data. When the data was first opened up, it was Dr. Krager, really, who was the first one who got access to the data. And his first reaction was, oh, we've completely, and not failed this in kind of the general sense that this is of no use, but we've completely failed what we tried to set out to prove, which is that this drug will increase the progression-free survival time of IPF patients. But look, there's some positive news. We can continue to study this drug. It's not all bad. It's just inconclusive. And that's what all the testimony at trial was. And that is really all the testimony that their witnesses said. And Mr. Mayer or Dr. Mayer was really only willing to say also that it's clinically significant, not statistically significant. I'd also quickly like to just move to the prejudice prong also of Strickland, which I think is also not met here, and for the reasons I've just said. If you look at the testimony of Dr. Mayer, he specifically says in his declaration, he told the attorneys, I'm not willing to say that this is statistically significant. And he also says, yes, I don't remember it specifically, but I could have told the attorneys the night before I was supposed to testify that this press release could be somewhat misleading. And he might want to cabin that, but it's a reasonable judgment of an attorney to say that if I'm paying somebody $159,000 to offer an opinion, and he can't even say that it's accurate, and he thinks that it might be misleading to some people, including the government's witnesses, that is not testimony that's going to help. So I'd refer you to Mr. Topel's declaration again, which is really concurred by attorneys Ager, Moorman, and Goodman. And I would ask you to find that there was no ineffective assistance in this case. This case is simply not a case that imperils free speech or scientific inquiry. It's a straightforward application of the wire fraud statute, and we'd ask you to affirm.
Right. Thank you.
The court asked for some citations. The defense declarations, the petitioner's declarations refuting all of the declarations of the Topel team are found at ER 93 to 127. Those are the declarations of Attorney Haddad, Attorney Winchell, Dr. Mayer, and Dr. Zebrak. And I very much recommend them to your attention. Counsel made a false statement, and I'm sure it was an oversight. She said that the press release did not state that it missed the primary endpoint. That's untrue. If you look at it, it says that it missed the primary endpoint at least twice. She said, oh, the problem really is, because they have to back off the argument they made to the jury and say, yeah, you can rely on other factors now after Matrix and so forth, but the discussion of the data was misleading and false. Specifically, and they say in their brief for the first time, the statement in the press release that the p-value for the relevant group was 0.004. You can read the government's closing argument from beginning to end. You will never find an argument there that statement in the press release was false. And the reason you won't find that argument is that one of the government's chief witnesses in this case, Dr. Krager, stated that he computed that 0.004, and it was correct and not wrong. He stated that, you'll find it at SER 2008 to 2010. So they didn't go near an argument that statement of statistical significance was false, because their own witness said that it was valid, and they in their brief state that there's nothing wrong with doing a p-value on secondary or tertiary endpoints. And contrary to what they say, and you can look at the law that I referred to in terms of Congress's 2012 Act, mortality is always relevant, and you will see that the FDA, by federal statute now, is to look at all kinds of evidence, but by federal statute, and that I've cited to the court, that never mentions key values, it never mentions statistical significance, and it allows the FDA to initiate expedited review and approval based on other forms of evidence without ever suggesting that it's required to consider, much less be controlled by key values and statistical significance.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, counsel. U.S. versus Harkonen.